Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the AWS Studio. This is episode 4 in our generative AI journey. We started the first three with Anthropic, really thinking about not just the art of the possible, but how Claude is available on Bedrock today. We've talked use cases with SK Telecom. But now we're going to really talk about the entire landscape of use cases and what that means for telcos and partners who want to get started. So I'm super excited to have you here with us, Chris. Thank you so much for joining us again.
Appreciate
episode
it.
Four, our final exploration at MWC this year.
I wish it wasn't. I wish we had 10 more, right?
So tell us a little bit more about your role and what positions you and your team to be covering these use cases.
Yeah, so my role is really centered on making sure that we can drive value in the customer, right? So we want to make sure that they're adopting technology and they get educated and insights so they can make the most educated decisions on what technology path will make the most sense for them, right? So what's the best business value driver? Indicative of that, what we do is we look at it from the perspective of what are going to be the core use cases that they need in order to accomplish that value driving, whatever that thing is that they want to accomplish. And so it's our responsibility then to look at the market, look at the technology, look at where the organizations are, and then just put together what's going to be something that's very strategic and also something very tactical that, again, accomplishes their goals, right? So, and it could be across a myriad of different things.
And today we're really talking about what's real today mm-hmm. and what can you implement with what's available across our breadth and depth of services. Mm-hmm. You've got Bedrock, you've got SageMaker, you've got Titan. There's so much to work with today. And customers are building on this right here, right now. Mm-hmm. What's a great example of what folks can look to beyond the SK Telecom story?
Well, first and foremost, just having Anthropic here with us was, very telling. And it's been really neat to dive in with them because it demystifies what a lot of folks believe is just the beginning of AI, but it is not. And in fact, you also need to take a step back, too, in terms of the breadth and depth of what we have at AWS from the perspective of all of these AI and ML services, because we've been at this a long time. And the key about that, in terms of the layers, whether it's focused on the chips or focused on the tooling and the AI ops perspective, right? Data prep all the way to model monitoring. But we have all of these AI managed services as well. And we get into a lot of these, not only the demystification, but also just trying to re-educate and reorient where people need to think about these things, because a generative AI model cannot solve everything, right? And a lot of people believe that they can. So when we jump into it, it's literally centered on, what's going to happen in an operations perspective? What does that do to drive value and efficiencies for them, right? Cost-saving metrics and measures. And then what is it for them in terms of driving more lifetime value and more revenue generating opportunities with the core basis of what makes them a functional business, which is their people.
So I have an idea. We have themes here this year at AWS. Yep. Our big why AWS is all about using the proven, robust, mature cloud mm-hmm. to transform telcos, reimagine consumer experiences, and digitize industries. Mm-hmm. I bet you we can take examples available today and map them to each of those three themes.
Yep.
Maybe we start with transforming telcos.
Yeah.
What's a use case that we're working on today that reflects that?
So we have to jump right into the operator journey. Right?
Okay.
So what does that look like? So that looks like, if you think about it from a perspective of, there's a pressure cooker for them to, the value statement or the value driver there is a pressure cooker for them to deliver more at a reduced cost for their customer. So how do you do that? Really, really difficult when we're also looking at next generation technologies, more data, faster pipes, because that's a huge cost and a burden to them, but then they need to be able to put that value and drive it to their customers, and they can't necessarily uplift, right, or ever increase. So what we look at, in terms of those are things like, let's take a broadband customer, for instance, right? Fixed line, we have, going out to their individual houses, right? We have the set-top boxes, and it's going to continue to, look at the television and all the key service and capabilities. Well, what happens when a node or something goes down for that service, right? Obviously, there's a customer experience, and we'll come to that later. But what happens in terms of the detection, the diagnosis, and the remediation? Usually, that's taking like 8 to 11 hours for a network engineer to figure out what is going on. That could be anything. That could be a denial of service. That could be a node just needed a new patch and didn't get it. It could be a who knows, a myriad of different things. And so part of what we've done with, you know, some of our customers is put in place all of the data and information centered around what are the customer, you know, what are the customers seeing, and let's pull that data in. What about the trouble tickets that we've seen, not only relevantly, but like in the past? What does that look like for the individual nodes and how they're communicating? And let's use a large language model to create the reasoning behind what's going on there and ask it questions. And so what that's given us the ability to do is take a large language model, apply it to very complex telco-related items in terms of communication and signaling and nodes and all the specifications, and take that detection, diagnosis, and remediation from hours to minutes.
If I dare ask the obvious question, rules engines today still apply. You still have basic anomaly detection. I have a certain value I'm measuring. It exceeds X, that equals alarm. Mm-hmm. That's still the case.
Yep.
But what we're doing now is the ability to prompt a large language model based on that data, or is it that the language model prompts itself and automatically starts to create
status? It depends. It's a good perspective, because it depends on what you want to do.
You're
spot on that we still have to use pattern recognition to understand, you know, like let's cluster, or let's do anomaly detection, or let's look at it from the perspective of, you know, when these predictive, you know, events occur, how do we actually get ahead of it? Mm-hmm. And then capture those events and then do something with it. Because I could capture an event and I have a node that goes down, but is it just, you know, a lot of noise that's coming off and nothing's really happening, or is it? So there's a lot of false positives and things that happen within these monitoring systems that, you know, produce so much information and cardinality at the same time, but do you necessarily know what's happening? So let's dive in and ask it questions and find out what's happening, because it doesn't matter, honestly, if the customer isn't getting, you know, the service that they are paying for.
And network operations is one very small portion of how generative AI can be used to transform telcos.
Yep.
Also a lot of opportunities in billing and customer 360, right?
Yep. So 80% of most customer calls are billing issues, right? So if you quantify that, that means that, one, they don't understand it. Two, they're trying to figure out, is it a past bill? Is it a forward bill? What does that look like? I mean, heck, you get even to, you know, scenarios where you get prepaid versus postpaid. And then what are all the bundled services? Do they get grandfathered in? There's a lot of complexities that come into those. And so when we look at that, yeah, we're utilizing some of these models to come up with what's the, you know, billing anomaly that may occur. And then if we find that billing anomaly, let's again pull that in, and if you wanted to, use a generative model to ask it questions to understand better, well, what is the bill? Why is it this much? What's going on with it? Am I being, you know, billed for upfront services? You know, all those types of things. So the whole piece about having a generative, you know, technology in there is really to just increase the productivity of whatever activity you're doing, right? Whether you're trying to understand something, you know, at scale.
So. And I'd be remiss if I didn't bring up the fact that developer productivity, forget the use case, you've got things like AWS Code Whisper services that help you build the very products that you're trying to achieve, which themselves could be a generative AI-based product, right?
Yep. So if we move from the operation side of things into the developer, you know, and the whole, you know, SDLC or software development lifecycle, there's definitely now and it's been one of the core pillars that generative has really taken off with, is code generation. Absolutely, like you said. But there's also more pieces to the code generation that come into it. What about the product management side of things? What about the user stories? What about those epics that need to be developed? A developer is only as good as the information that he's given or she's given in order to know what to develop to. And so if you don't provide that up front in a key way, I mean, I've been in so many scenarios as a product manager trying to, you know, help the developer understand, well, what is it that we're building? And they're asking me, well, how does this map to business value, right? And if I don't have those key pieces in there, then I can't do that. Generative models now are getting in and helping us understand, you know, setting the precedence around, I want to build an app that does X.
Right.
Great. What are all the core parameters that need to go into that? And do I need to stub the code out? Do I need to provide, you know, more framing and more context around what that epic is, so I can break it down into the right bite-sized chunks that I can put into the work item tractors and let it go.
I love the experiences you were mentioning, reflecting as a product manager, because I imagine a lot of what product managers are doing is thinking about how to reimagine consumer experiences, which is another huge area where we're seeing generative AI use cases really thrive, right?
Yeah. I think when we start looking at reimagining the customer experience, this is some of the most low-hanging fruit that if you look at like MWC and you go out and see what folks are doing, there's a lot of chatbots. Okay, great. You know, But there's also a lot of these scenarios around, how can I do next best action in a call center? Okay, again, low-hanging fruit. What does that look like for more self-service? Can I provide another chatbot? Again, low-hanging fruit. But what does it mean to understand, let's say, churn prediction? What does it mean to look across those channels and ask the simple question, am I solving problems or am I causing problems? Am I solving problems and causing problems across each channel? What does that look like? So you have to look at the diagnosis of those different areas. Maybe it is self-service, but I'm not doing anything of value across, let's say, a chat channel or an SMS channel or something that's more digital or something that's more social, right? But I am solving it every time I get on the phone. But then that's also my highest cost per customer is having a human talk to a human.
So it's not just one-to-one, it's one-to-many.
No, it is one-to-many, yeah. So when I look at those pieces and I think about it from the perspective of fraud detection or detraction of, you know, my services, what do I need to understand from, you know, those pieces? Or am I looking for fraud, right? Am I looking for those key elements and aspects of knowing what to do with that customer real time, you know, in a very tactical environment like a call center?
And can this be built out iteratively? You have a fraud detection solution that's already traditional ML-based rules engine. Then what do you do?
Yeah, utilize that data as a data point to take it in to understand what actions to take next. The beauty, like what you said, the pattern recognition models that we've been using for years are still 100% applicable, and we need them in order to understand as data points to figure out what that, and it should all be about accuracy. What do I need to do with Robbie as a customer that utilizes my broadband services but not my cell phone services? What does that look like? But I want to upsell him. So how do I get him, you know, in an upsell? Well, what about when he just had an outage? Is that the right time to talk to him about upgrading his services? No. So let's think about that from a perspective of creating some communication for him in an apologetic way and getting him to a sentiment that's more positive as opposed to continually hammering on him for, hey, you need to buy this, you need to, you know, do this.
So as we think about business impact, as we've talked about before briefly, we believe that these technologies can impact churn. Mm-hmm. We also believe that old metrics that we've previously used to measure sentiment, the likes of NPS, mm-hmm. may no longer be the strongest metrics to evaluate. Tell us a little bit more about the business impact here.
Yeah. I don't believe in NPS as a broad metric to measure your entire success. The reason for that is the mechanism behind NPS is really surveys. Okay? So let's break down, when do you want to take a survey?
Never.
Exactly. Never. Only maybe when you're mad, right? Because you want to stick it to the man, you know? So when we do those things, now we get a lot of, you know, false positives or false negatives in that information. So that's going to be your key metric that you're going to drive everything from, you know, these mad people. Now, as a point of data, I think it's awesome. Like, utilize that. CSAT, you know, whatever that may, you know, make up from a CSAT score, great. Do some things like that. But when we look at it from the overall lifetime value, that should be, you know, what has been the sentiment of the interactions that we've had over time? How many products do you have that you utilize? And, you know, what is that, you know, how, what's the length of time that you've been a customer, right? And do we have any indication that you might want to churn? That's when we start getting into some really interesting, you know, metrics around, you know, the most important thing is you feeling like you matter at scale.
So these are action-focused, impact-oriented mm-hmm. metrics that we're going to start to see emerge as telcos really take on transformation introduced by generative AI. And we believe, it sounds like, that's just the start where they can start to think about what are some other verticals that I can play in. And that's the entire notion of this idea of digitizing industries, right?
Yeah, because there's definitely in all of these, you know, in environments and stuff that we work with our customers, there's an element of what does this look like for them in their B2C, right? Their direct, you know, customer and consumer environment, but what this also looks like for their partners and their B2B type of scenarios. So do we give them the capabilities in the and these types of environments and technologies to then go to businesses that they've never thought of? So for instance, you know, like we've talked about in some of the other sessions, everything and everybody needs and wants to be connected, right? So these communication service providers and telcos now become a very nascent, you know, mechanism in the connectivity of life, right? If we start doing those types of things, then we look at this from the perspective of, well, what does a corrective action, preventative action system in a manufacturing environment need for connectivity? Well, a lot if it needs to do productive, or pre, you know, predictive or proactive maintenance. If it can get to the internet quicker and provide that, then it saves them a lot of time in terms of understanding how to solve their customers' problems faster. So it's a compounding effect, right? That we get in with all, if we can enable our true, connected customers and these folks that provide the connectivity, provide them with key capabilities, it extends their capabilities even more into, you know, these markets where others need that connectivity in order to make you know, their customers valuable.
And we're seeing that right here, right now, in our very coffee lounge, 300 some feet away, we have a smart home application that's using generative AI. We have a gaming application that's embedded generative AI. These are just some of the verticals that we expect to really be engaged, right?
Oh, all of them, right? Manufacturing, healthcare, financial services. Give me any industry that doesn't need connectivity these days. There isn't any.
I'm frozen.
Right? Yeah. There isn't anything that doesn't need connectivity. So now the pressure that we put on all of these carriers and these, you know, providers, it's, you start to get a sense of what it is instead of just driving down the road and being mad because I don't have, 5G, So there's a lot of things that we want to be able to enable them to do across this, their landscape and across the entire value chain. So we'll get into scenarios too where, what can generative AI do for a supply chain, right? And so customer experience, great. But what about when they're trying to provide more and more predictability into the planning and what this looks like for their devices and, on the consumer side? So there's so many fun, and really valuable use cases that we have today, that we're implementing today, as well as that are coming on the horizon.
So I'm still speechless from the question you asked before. I'm still thinking, I've got nothing all to say, that every vertical has an opportunity to leverage generative AI, and telcos have the right to play in each of these verticals by thinking about not only how they transform from within, but reimagine their own consumer experience to then leverage to each of these new opportunities and verticals. Yeah. So before we wrap up, Chris, I want to give you the final word. Practical advice to others. Again, this is our last of the four episodes touching on partner ecosystem, on early use cases, on customer wins. Where do you get started? There's so much here.
There's so much. I think the basis for this is to just take a step back and breathe and look at it from the perspective of the use cases that you have today, in terms of, am I solving problems or causing problems? And I think that's a hard look in the mirror at from the perspective of the customer side of things. Like, where is it that I'm actually really helping my customer? And not just the blanket, like we talked about NPS. Now, my NPS score went up 2 points. Great. Across what and where? Let's be hypercritical and self-critical about how we're actually doing that. And then from the perspective of looking at it from an operation side of things, I should be able to really start to squeeze, and utilize these technologies in a significant way to help me with, productivity. And that should be across not only the data and visualization and detecting what's going on within my network, as well as all the way through to the folks that are fixing the network. Like, let's provide them with some, areas of like some digital assistance for them to fix. Because, not everybody is that little network whisperer that can go knock on something and listen to the line attenuation and know, exactly what's happening and then go, push a button and that's it, fixes it. So there's just, a lot more capabilities that we can utilize to augment in a significant way some of these processes. And it doesn't need to be rocket surgery to do it. We don't need to like boil the whole ocean and have all the data there in order to get that done. We can do it in very, very simple steps and then just start just one piece at a time. But it's going to be, just the opportunity to look at the use case and see where is it that I can, just provide, more machine learning at scale to help me solve problems.
Well, it might not be rocket science, but you've definitely earned that generative AI ace pin that you have there on your jacket. So thank you, Chris, for joining us over the course of this multi-episode series. Thank you for shedding some insights, some use cases, and can't wait to see what the industry continues to build on AWS generative AI.
Thanks, Robert. Appreciate it.